my song. Oh, the desert will never take my song. I will praise you. Shouting of everything you've done. High up on the mountain, I was made to testify. Forever, you will have my song. Oh, forever. Stronger my faith grows. The higher the need, the higher I'll reach. The greater the cost, the more I'll believe for. The longer the wait, the longer I'll praise. The stronger the pain, the stronger my faith grows. The higher the greater the cost, the more I'll believe for. And I will praise you. I will praise you. I won't let the storms cry. I won't let the storms cry out. I will praise you. Something in me has to. I won't let the storms.
Pleasant afternoon, Florida. It is indeed my pleasure, my privilege sharing with you on this afternoon from God's words. I would like to greet you in the matchless name of Christ, and I trust that your day has been a fantastic day, that your worship was a beautiful day, and somehow, somewhere, God got to somebody because of the word that you brought or you heard in your setting, whether you were in church or you were on the Facebook or through Zoom, whatever means, whatever platform you were on, I trust that the word that you heard in your locale was of such that you were blessed. Somebody that you invited, and I hope you're inviting someone to listen to that word, somebody you invited was also blessed from the word. Today I speak to you from the book of Acts, and I will be looking at chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. But if I'm looking at that the book under the theme, The Scattered Church, it is essential that we look at a few things before we look at the text. The book of Acts, as you know, contains the history of the early church, Jesus Christ having been crucified and died and was buried, came forth from the grave and walked on the earth for some 40 days, instructing his followers concerning the kingdom of God. Before he left, he gave them instruction to go back to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. There he said, when he is come, you are going to receive power, and after that you are going to become witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. This group, young group, returned to Jerusalem. Just like Jesus promised, 10 days in waiting, the Holy Spirit came, baptized them. And that same day, Peter, in response to the detractors, preached a sermon. We saw about 3,000 persons coming to know the Lord. And they were added to the church. The church continued to grow. So much was the growth of the church that the church had to make special provision for persons who were coming in among them who were widows and needed special attention. Those brothers who were selected were called deacons or servers, 7 of them to be exact. But we see that this church was a growing church. Acts chapter 6 and verse 7 tells us that the word of God spread and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. And a great many of the priests were also coming into obedience to the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. But out of this group of 7 that were selected, we find one who was very, very special. His name was Stephen. He was a man who was filled, the Bible says he was filled with faith, filled with power, a man who did great wonders and signs among the people, which suggests that he was doing a bit more than serving these women. He was an evangelist in his own right. But this young church was at that particular time finding itself coming into opposition. Hear what the scripture tells us in chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. Now Saul was consenting to the death of Stephen. At that time, a great persecution arose against the church which was at Jerusalem. Which church? The church which was at Jerusalem. The same church that was experiencing great growth because of the word of God. And they were all scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering every house and dragging off men and women, committing them to prison. Verse 4. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. Peter, as I mentioned before, at his trial, spoke eloquently regarding Christ. Not only was he eloquent, but he was bold. And his message was Christ exalting and fearless. That kind of a preaching was not preaching for which you got a pat on the back. Not a kind of a preaching for which you got brownie points. That kind of a preaching, as Stephen would discover, could lead to death. In the text that we're looking at today, we see this as a very, very special time in the history of this young church. Chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus says, I want you to become witnesses here at Home Base Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then the rest of the world. But the church was still stuck in Jerusalem. And we must admit from the biblical narrative that work was being done. Growth was being experienced. So there was real need for work in Jerusalem. There was still need for preaching in Jerusalem. But the fact is, the commission was Judea, Samaria, and the rest of the world. But this young church was stuck in Jerusalem. We find from the text that something was happening. The church was being brought under tremendous pressure by the Jewish officials. In verse 1 of the text, Luke says it was a time of great persecution that was now arising in the church. I see this, my brothers and sisters, as a pivotal moment. A time in which the church was now being forced, not by their own design, to get up from home base and return to the full mission that God or Christ Jesus had called them to. It was a time when the young church must respond to persecution. It must now face the headwind of persecution. The killing of Stephen was a pivotal moment. It was the proverbial breaking of the camel's back by a straw. So we learn from the text that it was persecution that drove them out of Jerusalem. Not just persecution, but great persecution. Persecution inclusive of imprisonment. Persecution inclusive of martyrdom. It was at that time, the time of the martyrdom of Stephen. It was at that time of persecution, that this church now comes to the realization that it's time to move out from home base. It's time to move from the place of familiarity. It is time to move from a place where we're too comfortable. First, forced by their circumstances, the church now makes a hasty retreat. Can you step back with me and see in this the hand of God in their tragedy? The taking of Stephen's life and an intensifying persecution was serving to advance the thought of self-preservation. And so flight became a viable option. But we also see in this a divine setup. We see in this the man of God in the midst of his trial and at the time of his stoning, turning to God in an act of worship and inviting the men of the Sanhedrin to look, I see heaven open, and I see the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. We see him being stoned, Saul now giving consent to his death, and we see this man of God in the midst of his persecution, in the midst of his martyrdom. We find him in verse 60 of chapter 7. We find him falling on his knees and crying out in an act of worship, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Oh, my brothers and sisters, what a divine setup. Those who were accusing, those who are now consenting to his death, are now coming face to face with a life worship experience. Oh yes, led by someone who was being persecuted for the gospel's sake. What the church was experiencing was not easy. In fact, Bible tells us in the second verse of the text, devout men who carried Stephen to his burial, they made great lamentation over him. Anguish and pain at the loss of this deacon saw believing men burying him and openly weeping. Yes, my brothers and sisters, we see a church deeply grieving, mixed with fear, that was driving God-fearing people, driving them to contemplate, it's time to get up and leave Jerusalem. Deeply religious men wept uncontrollably. A void was created in this church as a giant of the faith is laid to rest, and the thought must have resonated within them that we could be next. We see in the third verse, Saul creating havoc, imprisoning both men and women alike. Gender was not a concern, as equal punishment was being meted out to all. I would to God this day that you and I could see within this text something that we could grab a hold of as we now grapple with the issues of our current time. Pressed by their reality, the young church is forced to reassess its position, to stay in Jerusalem or to leave. God was causing their plight, their hardship, their enemies, to move them to fulfill his will, to make known the manifold riches of his grace to a brand new people. Question for you this afternoon. Can we find a parallel in our time where a change in circumstances is forcing us to make a move? Can we identify a time when we were forced to give up the familiar and learn the unfamiliar? As our churches become too comfortable in our beautiful surroundings, our Jerusalem. As our churches become too comfortable stroking each other's ego, while Judea and Samaria are waiting for the message that we carry. Has our churches, a question for you, become too comfortable in our beautiful edifices, while Judea and Samaria are waiting for this gospel of hope, this gospel of the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ? Not churchy folks, but persons who are messed up and rejected by society, persons who are longing for love, a love which we now possess and which is ours to give to others. As COVID-19 played the role of the persecutor, wiping everything out that is in its path. As COVID-19 become our sword, if so, how have we responded? And how are we responded? Some pressures, my brothers and sisters, are necessary. Some hardships should be welcomed as they push us in the direction of God's will. God has a purpose for our lives. I know we have some plans of our own, but it is the Lord's plans that are going to prevail. Proverbs chapter 19 and verse 21. We see, as I mentioned earlier on, Jesus tells his disciples in chapter 1 and verse 8, go to Jerusalem and go to Judea, go to Samaria, go to the uttermost parts of the earth. But successes were keeping them bound, chained to Jerusalem. But God, in the midst of their persecution, is now driving them to fulfill the command which Jesus Christ had earlier on given. Brothers and sisters, you and I must be willing. We must be prepared. We should seek the face of God to the extent that we can discern when the Jerusalem assignment has expired and move on to fulfill God's purpose for our lives. Jerusalem was not a permanent assignment. It was a first stop. It was first base. Just that and no more. And neither is ours. As God effectively moved us into a new area of ministry, and are we still struggling with the thought of going back to the old path? You see, my brothers and sisters, every opposition, every time of difficulty, every time of persecution is an opportunity for us to reposition for God's blessing. I want to encourage us today, as you hear this word that God has for us, that we see anything that we are going through as a possible opportunity to reposition for something that is greater from the hand of God. Years ago, when I was a youngster, probably about 2 or 3 years after I came to the Lord, our church was moved to go into a new community that was being established to do an outdoor Sunday school. The Sunday school was growing to the extent that we became engaged in the mapping of the community, directing individuals to grab a hold of particular streets, praying over them, and in due season to go into homes witnessing with the message of the gospel. With that ongoing development among the young people, at the time it was the youth life team of the church, we began to do street meetings to the extent that we would see people were coming to the Lord Jesus Christ, and we were now beginning to see the opportunity, the possibility of another church being planted. But somewhere, somehow, we lost hope of the harvest. And we felt it was time to be back in the church. Too much time was being spent in the field. And so we shut that down and we went back into the building. This day, God has not forgotten that community. A building is at the spot that we were meeting, but our church name is not on it. We must discern what God is saying. God has effectively moved us into a new area of ministry, and we must be willing to follow. But secondly, we observe from the text that they were all scattered, but not the apostles. Pastor Heron, what does that mean? see, my brothers and sisters, very often we are of the view that the message of the kingdom, the preaching of this message, is a purview of the clergy. But that's not found in the text. The story is told of a hardcore church brother whose theology did not include evangelism. He was confronted by a young, enthusiastic prospect for ministry who wanted to know why he did not believe in evangelism. He claimed that the Great Commission was given to the apostles and it was completed in their day, and so it was not for us. The young preacher said, "Let's see what the Bible says about that." He turned to this very passage in Acts chapter 8 and showed this hardened church brother where Luke said they were all scattered except the apostles. The apostles remained in Jerusalem, but the scattered church gave witness to the gospel wherever it went. Wherever they went, Christ's followers witnessed to the majesty, the might, and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hear what Luke says in Acts chapter 11, verses 19 and 21. "Now those who had been scattered by the persecution that broke out when Stephen was killed traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, spreading the word only among the Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks, also telling them that the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord." It is critical, it is crucial, I believe, in this era, in this time, that the church of the living God recognize the opportunity that are at our disposal for the spread of the gospel. It cannot be church the old way. It cannot be the familiar church. We need a church that's unfamiliar. A church that recognizes that the Spirit and the power of God cannot be chained. God, as Stephen was correcting before the council, is not a God who can be held in a building. Heaven is his throne. Earth is his footstool. I say to us this afternoon, as the people of God, let's lift up our eyes and see the tremendous possibilities, the tremendous potential for the church of the living God to be a living, dynamic witness to our communities, whether through Facebook or YouTube, whether on the street corner, whether in the school, wherever we are, to be that people who are presenting the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, not bound to 2 hours in a building, but all the word of God is unchained, released through spirit-filled men and women, crying out, "Abba, Father," much like Stephen did when he was being stoned. As this virus opened your eyes to your Judea and your Samaria, or are you eager to go back to Jerusalem? Are you open to where Spirit is leading you, or are you anxious to return to your building? Father, rest with us. Open our eyes and show us what you are sending us to. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you, God, for this week. We thank you for this month. And Father, we even thank you for this year. We thank you that in the midst of all that we've encountered so far this year, Lord God, you've proven to be a keeper. You've proven, Lord God, to be a comforter. You've proven time and time again that you know all things, see all things, feel all things, and you are not caught off guard by anything that we face. We pray, Lord Jesus, that as we continue, that as we face issues, we face trials, as we face challenges in our lives, challenges to our faith, challenges, oh Lord God, all around us, that our faith will increase and our hope will be steadfast in you. And that, oh Lord, as the pressures increase all around us, that we, your children, at all times will be representative of you. That, Lord, as we are facing pressures on all sides, that what shall come out will be a testimony, a witness of the God that we serve, that your love will pour out of us, your peace, Lord Jesus, will come bursting forth, that your light will shine through and from us. We pray, oh God, and we ask that for those who are facing grief, loss, those, oh Lord Jesus, who are dealing with a change in life that they did not expect, that they do not feel prepared for, those, oh Lord Jesus, who are handling so many issues, oh God, be it in their families or on the job or be it in their health, oh Lord God, I pray that, Lord, they will hold to you. They will hold to him, to you, the one who is, who was, and who is to come. Hold to you, the one who is indeed the way maker, the one who still does miracles, the one who still does mighty wonders, that they will stand still in the midst of storms and see the salvation of their Lord. May we, O God, at all times be witnesses of you. May we at all times, Lord God, keep our eyes on you so that others will see, will come seeking for that peace, that hope that we have, and will find their Savior. So I pray, Lord God, that your grace will continue to go before us, that your peace will overwhelm us, and that your joy, your strength, that it shall fill us as we go on day by day. It is in your Son's name we pray, and all together we say,